In today's class, we will be studying the bridge engineering, where we are going to study about the deep in the substructure. So we saw that in the substructure, there are many other elements, right, which support the bridge of the superstructure, right? So we are going to understand what are those and what are its functions. So this is your fourth lecture of the bridge engineering, right? So we'll get into it. We'll be studying about the cofferdam. What is cofferdam? Why it is required? Is it necessary to provide a cofferdam? We'll first understand what is cofferdam, right? Next is bridge substructures. There is abutments, piers, wing walls, right? These are the main components of the substructure. So first we'll understand what is cofferdam, right? So can you see this image here? In this image, it is trying to say that whenever you want to have a bridge in a river or a sea, right, we have seen many bridges which are over the seas or which are in the rivers, right? So when you want to construct a bridge, you have to construct a foundation for it. So how you are going to construct a foundation in a sea? So what we do is, in a sea, wherever we want our foundation to be laid and its dimensions, we are going to put a casing around it. If suppose consider this is your some area of free sea, right, and you want a foundation in this area, right? So what we'll do here, it consists of all seawater, right? It consists of seawater, right? But we want a area which has no water so that we can construct a foundation for it, right? And we can raise the piers or abutments. So in that case, what we do is we enclose this area, right, in such a way that it is, we conclude hollow enclosure is done so that whatever the inner water is there here, the water which is available in the casing, right? Can you see like this? Right? Once we enclose that area through a hollow enclosement, right, we put some such a structure that water doesn't enter into this foundation area, right? As you can see here, we have enclosed that area with some steel structures so that water doesn't enter into it. Once we construct that, what we do is we remove the water from this portion. We put the pumps and we remove the water and throw it outside that structure, right? Once we remove that water, then that area becomes useful to construct the foundation, right? So whatever structure we provide to enclose the water body inside the water body and remove that water, right, so that we can construct the foundation and substructure of the bridges. This is also done in case of construction of dams, where we provide such structures and divert the water, river water, from another place so that the water doesn't flow in the direction of the construction of foundation, right? If I show you the this is your pathway of bridge of a river. River is flowing in this direction, right? So we want to construct a dam here, right? We want to construct a dam here, but due to the flowing water in this direction, we can't construct in the water. So what we'll do, we will put this structure before the dam structure, long before the long structure, and we'll divert the water in this direction. Right, we construct a such structure which will stop the flow of water in the direction of its order way, and we will provide such divergence for the river to flow. Now, once we are close to the waterway, and so water is not flowing in this direction, we are free to construct the rivers. So the structure which is used to obstruct the water, so the water should not enter into the area that we want, so we construct such structure. That structure we construct to remove the water and not to allow the water to enter, that is called as cofferdam. It's like a dam, right? It retains water, it stops the water, so it's called as cofferdam. You can able to see here, there is water all around, right? We have constructed and we have removed the water from it, and now they are entered into the area and they are working here, right? So that is what is cofferdam, right? Cofferdam is a temporary structure constructed. It is temporary because once the construction is over, we remove that structure so the water can flow easily, right? Cofferdam is a temporary structure to prevent the water entering into the area and makes it possible to carry the construction work under a reasonable dry conditions. We can't make it fully dry because there will be some pores. It might be groundwater, water might be entering some because it is a sea or a bed, river bed or sea bed. So in that case, we can't fully restrict the water, but we can reasonably stop the flowing of water into the area where we want to construct the structure, right? So that is what is called as cofferdam, this temporary structure which is used to prevent the water to enter the construction area when we are constructing in the water bodies, right? So that is called as cofferdam. Cofferdams are usually required in the construction of hydraulic structures such as dams, right? Lock construction of bridge in piers and abutments, right? As the piers with their foundations are constructed underwater, some devices are required to exclude the water, right? So these are the devices which are used, right, for the underwater construction, where these have constructed counteracting the bridge, constructing of the bridge. Cofferdams are used to hold both earth and the water, keeping it away from the working areas and dry, right? Uses of cofferdam. Where do you use cofferdams, right? In the last sentence, they have said that it is not only used to obstruct or prevent the water to enter, also for to obstruction of the earth. Earth means soil, right? First one is to facilitate piles driving operations, where you want to drive the piles into the foundation, right, in the under in the water. At that time we can't guess the topography and what where exact locations. So first we have to remove the water and then exact locations of the pile driven can be operation can be started. So for that we have to use cofferdams to construct the foundation of the piers, abutments of the bridges, dams and locks, right? place of grillage and raft foundation while placing, while concreting of the raft foundations, right? We have to place the reinforcements, we have to provide the formwork to it, right, on the sides, and we have to have a concreting work to be done. So for all those cases, we require a cofferdam to avoid the water to enter into the areas. To enclose the space for removal of sunken vessels. So what happens is, in some cases, during the movement of ships for trade or any other purpose, when ships is moving, okay, so when it's due to some errors of the ship, it sunks into the sea, right? It drowns into the sea. So in that case, now the search party or the search, the police, the coastal guards will search for such ships because it is missing. So once they come to know that the ship is missing and they come to know the location of the ship, it is below here. So what they do is, along the ship, which is underground, under the bed, will put the cofferdams, will remove the water from it, and will remove the ship from there. Only when we know exact location of it, it is used to remove the sunken vessel. Vessel means ship. To provide a working platform for a foundation when water is to be met with, right? It is provided as a working platform because people have to enter the foundation, right, under the seabed, right? So that people can work, concreting can be done, people have to do it. So people can't enter into the water and do the construction works, right? So for that purpose, it works as a platform for working for the foundations. Next, we'll come for various substructures. What is abutment? What is pier? All those we'll study today. The portion of bridge structure below the level of bearing and above the foundation, generally referred as substructure. Right, which is below the bearing. We have saw in the previous lecture about components of bridge. In that, we saw where is bearing, what is the superstructure, what is substructure, and what is foundation, right? So whatever is below the bearing and above the foundation is called as substructure. The first structure is piers, right? Next is abutment and wing walls. Approach. I have told you what is approach is in the previous lecture. If you have seen my previous lecture, you will know what is approach, right? Piers are the intermediate supports of the superstructure in case of the multi-span bridges. These are, you can see in only multi-spans, means in the culverts you can't see the piers. When there are more than two spans, two or more spans of a bridge, then you will see a pier. Right, the intermediate supports of the bridge. A pier usually consists of two parts, column or a shaft, and a foundation. It consists of shaft or a column and a foundation for it. It is something sometimes provided with the projections called as cut water and ease water, for the easy passage of water. Now what is this cut water and ease water? We will understand. Okay. So if you see here, this is a multi-span bridge which has a T-beam. Can you see this? It is a T-beam bridge, RCC, right? These are the intermediate piers. These are two piers because the length of the width of the bridge is long, so they are provided two piers. These are the piers. Can you see this? Because there are lot of spans, these intermediate support structures will support the bridge, right? It is intermediate means in between, right? In between the two ends, in between the two ends, these are being provided. Can you see this? Here there is a foundation below, right? And this is called a shaft or this is called a shaft, and this is below this you have a foundation, right? This is called a column or a shaft. Now, can you see this edge portion? Can you see this edge portion here? If the water is flowing in this direction, you will see a edge portion this side, right? What is cut water and east water? If whenever the water is flowing, okay, if you see the plan, it is like this. This is how the pier looks, right? If the water is flowing in this direction, to cut the velocity or to cut the water so that it doesn't obstruct, because continuous hitting of water to the piers might deteriorate the piers. So to easy way for the waters, for to have easy passage of water to flow without obstructing the piers or without resisting the piers, what we do is we provide some cut portion like this, so that it tears the water easily and waters moves in the y direction, right? Moves in this direction. Water coming from here will cut down and move this side and this side, right? And the east water is to the downstream side, this side, right? This is provided on the downstream side. This, the edge portion is called as cut water because it will cut the water, and the east water is for again rejoining. The water should again rejoin, right? If the water is flowing in this direction here and from here, it will again join and it will move again here in front. So it will allow easy flow of water after it goes to the downstream side, right? So that is for east water, that is cut water what we have studied. This is what is pier is. Next is abutment. So first we'll understand what it is. The end support of the bridge superstructure, the end support of this bridge superstructure is known as abutment. As I said, if the bridge is multi-span, then it requires intermediate supports, right? Then those intermediate supports are called as piers. The end supports, as it when the start of the bridge and to the end of the bridge, this is the start of the bridge, right? And this is the end of the bridge. So at that portion, we provide a support. That support is called as abutments. It is called as abutments. I have marked here with the red pen, right? This portion is abutment. You understand? This portion is abutment. This whole portion, which is I have marked with the red line, right? That is your abutment. This bridge, the example which I have shown here, it is less than 8 meter span, so it is a culvert, right? In case of the longer spans also, it will, the abutments will be there. Two abutments should be there, because there is always there is a start of a bridge, always there is an end of the bridge. So there will be a abutments in every bridges, but in the case of culverts, there will be no piers, because it is a small bridge, doesn't require any intermediate supports. Intermediate supports comes when the length of the span of the bridges are multi-spans, or the length of the span is very bigger. That time we go for piers, right? Whatever I have marked with the red color, that is considered as abutments. They retain earth on the back, which serves as an approach to the bridge, right? This is an approach road, right? Which is connecting the road which is connecting the bridge is called as approach road on the both the sides. So we have to increase the height of this bridge, right? Add to this height. So what will fill inside here? Will fill earth. So it what will do, behind this abutment, there will be a earth, right? behind this abutment there will be earth to retain, so that it forms an embankment for it, so that the level of the bridge and the road should be same, approach road and the bridge should be same. For that case we do the embankment, right? For a river bridge, abutments also protected from scoring, right? I just showed what is scoring. Digging up of or removal of soil, right? From its bed. So in that case, to protect it, in that case we provide abutments in the river bridges. That is about abutment and supports which retains earth, and in case of the bridges, river bridges, it also protects us from the scoring of earth which is retained behind it, right? Now what is wing wall? These wing walls are provided at the ends of the abutment to retain the earth filling of the approach road. For the approach road to approach the bridge, right, you retain the earth. But I showed the abutment is for a particular distance. If you see here, if you see this portion, this is your abutment, right? But this is not your abutment. This is what is the wing wall is, which protects the earth along the approach road. So that structure which protects the earth along the approach road is wing wall, which is perpendicular to the approach road, that is abutment, and those are two end supports. These walls are constructed of same material as that of abutments, right? They are of constructed of same material that of abutments. Design of wing walls depend upon the nature of banks, type of bank and how the water is flowing. The topographical nature depending upon that we decide which type of wing wall is to be provided. Their face water is either kept vertical or battered. Battered means inclined. In the previous image, if you see, it was straight because there is no water face water. Water face. If there was a water, they would go for battered. This is battered. Means it has slope like this. This is how it looks when you cut it in section. This is what we are looking for. Even when you are looking it, it looks, you look from here. This is the inside portion where it returns earth. This is your wing wall, how it looks if it is battered. If it is straight, it will look like this with foundation. Right? It retains earth. Right? Types of wing wall. As I said, it depends upon the type of wing wall. There are various types: straight wing walls, split wing walls, and return wing walls. So we'll see what are these. Right? This is a straight wing wall because they are straight in nature. They are straight, right? If you see it, it is like this. These are your abutments and these are your wing walls. Right? This is your wing wall. Right? They are straight. The next one is the split. Split is this, which are at an angle. Right? This is your abutment. And you construct it like this, right? If it is provided at an angle, then those are called as splayed ones. You can see here in this image, it is splayed. The splayed ones are been used in the river, right? River banks where there is a water flowing, so we so that we can safeguard the embankment which is done here. Can you see here the embankment of the stones is been done? So to avoid water to get in contact with those embankments, we go for the splayed ones. In the case of the railway or a highway bridge, right, where there is no water flow, that case we go for straight wing walls. And in case of the cities where we are providing the bridges for railways and highways, the space is constrained. The space is the constraint, means there is no more space for to go for splayed ones, right? Splayed ones require larger area than the straight ones. So we try to go for the straight upper wing walls in the case of cities where we are constructing the bridges. In the case of rivers, we have to provide a splayed one so we can protect the embankment of the approach roads, right? So these are what we are talking about for today's class. We have studied about the cofferdam, what is cofferdam, where it is used, right, and various components of the bridges substructure, various components of substructures, right?